Bonsoir. Good evening. Welcome to the Canadian Cultural Centre. Bienvenue au Centre culturel canadien. My name is Graham Clark. Je suis le chef de mission adjoint ici à l'ambassade et très heureux de vous accueillir ici au Centre culturel canadien. Très heureux aussi de souligner la qualité du travail du centre qui a passé par des années de vaches maigres et qui, maintenant, je crois, sous l'impulsion d'un nouveau gouvernement à Ottawa, reprend toute sa place. And it's a very good thing, actually. Government has a role in supporting culture, in supporting cultural diplomacy, and I think that this center is emblematic of that mission, of that vocation. So welcome this evening around Edward Bertinsky, qui s'organise à l'occasion du lancement de la sortie de son nouveau livre « Éléments essentiels » et sa présence ici pour Paris Photo. Et nous sommes aussi ravis de pouvoir bénéficier de la présence de William Ewing, qui a dirigé la conception du livre dont ils vont vous parler et la préfacer, ainsi que de Jennifer Beschwall, qui est la réalisatrice du film que certains d'entre vous auront vu plus tôt ce soir et qui s'intitule Watermark. Qui est Edward Bertinsky? Edward, I'm going to speak in French because most of the conversation, as I understand it, is going to be in English. So I'll present you and William in French. Photographe canadien, ses ouvrages précédents comprennent Water, Oil, Quarries, tous parus chez Steidl, ainsi que Manufactured Landscapes, coupe publiée par le Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada et Yale University Press. Il a reçu de nombreux prix, dont le TED Prize, le prix Outreach des rencontres d'art, le Roloff Benny Book Award et le prix Rogers du meilleur film canadien. William Ewing est auteur, conférencier, commissaire d'exposition photographique et a été directeur du musée de l'Élysée de Lausanne de 1996 à l'an 2000. Ses nombreuses publications sur la photographie comprennent Le Corps, œuvre photographique sur la forme humaine, Masterclass Arnold Newman, Landmark, The Fields of Landscape Photography et Lois Greenfield, Moving Still. Monsieur Ewing est également commissaire d'exposition auprès de la Fondation for the Exhibition of Photography à Lausanne ainsi qu'à la Fondation Karen. Quelques mots sur le déroulement de notre soirée. Catherine Bédard, qui est la directrice adjointe et la commissaire aux expositions du Centre culturel, va animer un entretien qui se déroulera en anglais. Et Jennifer va se joindre à vous, si j'ai bien compris, Catherine, vers la fin, pour qu'elle puisse répondre aux questions du public. Est-ce que j'ai oublié quelque chose? Non? C'est parfait. Très bien. Je vous souhaite une bonne soirée et un bon entretien.
We will talk about the book Essential Elements, éléments essentiels, qu'on va retrouver sous la forme anglaise et française tout à l'heure pour la séance de signature. Voilà. And we'll try not to be mixed up with it, between French and English. So, Edward, your work, we will not talk about all your work because it's a huge subject in itself, but it's a work about mass production, about consumerism, about globalization. You go far away to bring back to us very powerful images, one of which we see here, that is taken at Silver Lake. You are an artist, you're a documentary photographer, and maybe those titles are submitted always to certain discussions in your work. But you're also an explorer. I would say not an explorer of the unknown, but of what should be known. Would you say that, of the what should be known? You explore the world on that.
I feel that this is something that these landscapes were all connected to. And I had the kind of chance early in my life to work in these places. So I worked in mines up in the north, northern Canada, around Red Lake, and I saw open pit copper mines and iron ore mines, and worked in a mine even. And I worked in big factories to put myself through school. So I recognized that there was this other world that was expanding at an incredible rate, at a scale that most of us don't understand. And so very early in my career, 1981-82, it occurred to me that it would be a powerful thing to begin to try to, you know, create a compendium of images that kind of speak to that, the extraction, the taking of the things that we need to create our worlds. And in many ways, you know, of course, I'm implied in all these landscapes. And, you know, I at one point it occurred to me when I was, you know, shooting a mine in Chile, the Atacama Desert, that hadn't seen rain for 50 years at that time. It was the second biggest copper mine in the world, and at one point was supporting 30% of copper for the world. And I thought, probably everybody on a daily basis engages somewhere through telecommunications or windings in your car or so, with that copper, but no one knows about it. It's in the middle of nowhere. You'd never get there. So I think that was that kind of reconnecting the disconnect that I felt happens when we live in our cities and we live in our loops and we feel comfortable because, you know, our car is there and our food is, you know, at the store and everything, you know, feels normalized. But there's this ever-growing world out there that's commiserate to the growing populations and commiserate to the new populations coming on stream that are becoming consumer-based populations. So I felt, even in the early 80s, that building a body of work consistently for throughout my life, because I saw it as a lifetime project, that eventually these things as an aggregate would tell a large story about humans and the relationship to nature and the planet.
But you want to make people become conscious of something? Do you think there's like a complexity between feeling of guilt and admiration that we can have in front of your images? Because you go far away, you make us conscious of things that we're not aware, or we don't want to be aware of, or we deny simply. Some people deny that. I was wondering if you are aware of the mixed feeling we can have. Like we feel guilty to admire, which is a very provocative tension, a strong tension that you maintain from image to image, and that needs to be there in order to avoid any seductive power of the image.
Well, I think that what you're talking about is, I am conscious of that, and it to me it allows the image to remain dynamic versus static. Mm-hmm. That when you have these conflicting emotions, and that it's, if I put my work out the whole time, number one, I wouldn't be able to get into the places. So I had to be careful of how I framed what I did, that I'm not coming at it as an environmentalist, but as an artist who's interested in large-scale industry and how it expresses itself out there in the world. And that one can take these images and use them as an indictment, as much as you can take one of these images and put it on the cover of their annual report. It can function in both of those worlds very easily.
But you try to control also a lot, of course, the use of those images, because we can see them, yeah, in magazines on the environment and many different subjects. But
I do try to control it, but I'm always trying to ensure that how it's being used, it isn't being used as just a tool to describe a story, that it functions alongside stories, that it has its own kind of built-in layers of meaning, and the meaning isn't fixed, that you can look at it and say, well, you know, like this picture here, a miner could deconstruct that and see all the different tools that they're using, how they're going about it, how deep the ore begins, you know, there's a lot of things somebody who knows how to read a landscape like that could read from that picture. So that has that documentary value. Then an environmentalist can look at that and say, well, this is how, you know, we extract at scale. This is an example of, you know, how water gets, you know, tainted and all. Or you can look at it as, you know, from a history of art and through color and color field painting and the flattening of the image and abstract expressionism and all the other reference points that I might be doing in art. And that's a legitimate layer too. So I'm not saying if you own this print and you walk down the stairs, you can one day look at it for its environmental, and the other day you can look at it for its what it is as what references to the history of art that I'm also playing with. So I think I do like the fact that there is
multiple entries,
multiple layers, because it makes the it, it, like I said, it moves it from a static work. Because if you say this is an indictment against it, you then end up being very didactic and end up being one-dimensional when you describe what it is. And then people associate that with an environmental message, and then that's the only way people begin to perceive it. So it's, I think it's far more interesting and makes a greater dialogue when you can move through different readings.
Mm-hmm. And speaking about different readings, William, you choose this image out of many others and essential elements, but it's very interesting because you have a curatorial approach. We were talking about that earlier, as if you were organizing an exhibition in a book, in a way. And we can talk about the fact that books are still then very important today because we can play with them in a different way than in an exhibition. So what was your different perspective doing that book compared to the other books that are thematic projects?
Well, in fact, I was much freer with this concept of mixing all Ed's 20 more or less bodies of work together in a very bizarre way, in the sense that there's never two pictures from the same project on a double page. Yeah. It's always one project, maybe 15 years apart, and that's the language of the book. But I was free to do that because Ed had so many books, one subject books already with Steidl. So I wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have even proposed it if those other books, Quarries, Mines, China, Water, Oil, if they hadn't already existed. I felt, well, this book should complement all those. Anybody who's a fan of Ed's has all those books, and this gives them an opportunity, almost like an index, to pull back, look down, the way Ed looks down, and see the whole thing, but grasp it in an intuitive way rather than an academic way. I did kind of inoculate myself in the book by listing all the projects in the first few pages. They're all there like it's like a high school term paper.
And how
so that I felt at least I was safe to then start my own game.
And so you're dismantling, if we can use that word, a thematic approach, the project approach that are very coherent in the other book. But at the same time, you're in a way dismantling a narrative, because in all your books, like Water, China, there is some kind of a narrative. There's a narrative structure. There's a story about water structured in the book. So you're dismantling all that, but at the same time, you were talking about intuitive approach, but it means you still have a knowledge and an understanding of those projects. That is a very deep understanding.
Well, that's the way you have to start. You have to start by mastering all that. And and Ed was very generous from the beginning. He gave me free run of the studio. I never saw him looking over nervously to see how I was opening something up I shouldn't be opening up. But I ended up looking at basically everything he did. And I put aside all my preconceptions. I just looked at pictures, And I allowed those pictures to start speaking to me. And what interested me was the fact that I began to see these common elements. Maybe you could call it an infrastructure, something just under the surface. But everything is paired in the book. There's never a single image. And the pairings follow different principles. Mm. This particular one you've put up may be worth, because it's the most literal. Ed had said earlier in his career that it was photographing towers like this that made him realize that all that stuff had to come out of the ground, so there must be corresponding holes in the ground. And when he said this, and I saw that picture, and if we were a little closer up, you'd see the geometry, the mathematics is so perfect. I mean, they're just gleaming. I mean, you could lick them. The cleanliness of them, the precision, the geometric forms, and on the right, that hole in the ground, rough in every other sense, but there was a color palette that the images shared. That's what really struck me. So when I put them together, believe me, there were infinite hours spent playing with them. I print them all up as playing cards, and I put them out on tables and I move them around. And I get up in the middle of the night and I go back down and I move them around again.
You started with like 350, right? Like
some small pictures. Yeah, that's right. I think actually we started with 500 first round, and I let things marinate. I let them sit around. And we had an advantage in that Ed was in Toronto and I'm in Lausanne. So it meant that we only got to see each other every 6 months. That's great, because every 6 months, both of us have had time, and also Marcus and Ed's other people, in some of whom you saw on the screen earlier, in Toronto, they'd also come back and say, you know, Bill, I think you should look at this. Marcus was great that way. And so they'd pull more things out. If we had tried to do that in one session, we would never have come up with a book like this.
With what then? What would have changed?
You have to let things marinate. You have to, you know, lots of people who do good books put things up on the wall and let them sit there for 6 months. And it's after 6 months that you go, oh, that's not working, or that really works. You know what really works well. I don't put them up on the wall because it's too much effort to pin them, and I like them flat on the table. But in every case, you can see the forms there. There's the cross-like form at the bottom of the quarry, and this building that's falling. I was just struck by the commonality of that. But it's Ed's organization of space that allows that to happen. It's not an accident. You can pair things. You could take this book, cut it up, and do your own pairings. And I look over your shoulder, I go, hey, not bad. Or I might say, oops, better than what I've come up with. It's not as if this is the only pairing. It's not. By no means, but it spoke to me, and again, with these 6 months visits, I was able to keep Ed and his people, up with how I was thinking, and so the book evolved gradually.
And so here, it's not a literal pairing. I agree with you. The first one I put was literal, but not. Not first degree in a way, because it was not that query that was linked to that city. But here, what's interesting, so I wanted to show a few pairings, because then you bring us in very different worlds and dimensions of Ed's work. And so here you have what we don't see at first, of course, the fragility, vulnerability of the people that are there, because there are people there. And also the rudimentary machinery in relation with something that is very heavy material. So did you have the feeling that you have like different procedure of devices when you were constructed the book, or still it's very intuitive, because it's true that here we have something else that speaks about people.
It's actually several layers simultaneously. Sometimes it's geometric form, sometimes it's color palette, sometimes it's a kind of literal idea or a figurative idea, sometimes it's even a kind of event. In this case, there is a very stable image in the quarry, and this sense of movement and the toppling, something about to happen or something happening on the left, and I thought that was also something that gave it a new dynamic. I might add something to this idea of rethinking the global view of Ed's work. I read everything that people had written, and I read some pretty terrific texts, many of which are in Ed's books, but many of which are in magazine articles and so on. So working with him and his staff and a wonderful intern, Laura, we identified 36 texts, I think it is, 36 texts that seem to be key. And we use those throughout the book to kind of animate it, to break pictures. There are five sections in the book. Each has a feel. It's like a symphony. There's five movements. Do symphonies have five movements? Well, this one does.
Depends.
and each one is broken by these texts. And the texts were carefully chosen for the voices. So that's part of it, too. And I also felt that if we're trying to complement Ed's all his title books, that this, by bringing all the authors together, this also makes the book more valuable.
Absolutely, and those quotes are magnificent, and some authors come back and back in different sections of those quotes. Ed, this is one of the images that is linked to another one similar. It's the only one that is not a pairing, but a diptych. Yeah, so that's a ship-breaking series taken in India. Can you speak about that series, and because I think it's interesting. It's like an anchorage in the book, because it probably one of the only diptychs. So,
but it's when it becomes a triptych, because in fact, sorry, I'll have to show it with this. That's the first pairing you see. So that Borromini Renaissance sculpture here, a water pivot there, Baroque. Just testing you to see. He told me he's very tired. I thought he might be asleep. So the idea is that the book works this way and this way. So because it becomes a kind of triptych. All of this is very academically incorrect, really. I could get fired from the College of Curators.
And that decontextualization, Ed, is not for you. It's, I mean, is it? Are you discovering something of your own work in that kind of recontextualization of your images, or?
Well, what's interesting is I think, and I guess subconsciously, and even to some degree consciously, when I do work, you know, even the name of the book, Essential Elements, and it's something that I worked on early in my career. And I kind of equate it to a musician kind of doing scales or learning, you know, scales on a piano or on a stringed instrument and going through them again and again and again. But I was doing a lot of work in like northern and, you know, southern Ontario, looking at kind of the deciduous forest after the leaves drop, really complex swampy areas, wetland areas, and just trying to concentrate on how to frame, how to cut everything away until what I call you to get to the essential elements that make the image. Everything belongs in that frame. And it's a really interesting process, because I think, you know, I still haven't found any environments in the world like we have in a forest when the leaves are down and the structure of the trees and the grasses and the grass. When you walk in the city, you don't have that kind of complexity. You know, it's all kind of pavement, bricks, all of that. So it is that kind of reduction is it's what you disclude to get down and boil it down to that one frame. And when you get it, it's funny, in that chaos, all of a sudden it feels like it should have always been a picture. There's something interesting that happens. And then you attenuate a kind of antenna that dials in. So if I walk in the forest now, I don't see
you
that.
You see a picture of yourself.
I don't know. I just don't know. I just don't see that anymore. I'd have to go back and start to train my eye and my mind to find those things again. I don't see them anymore. So when I go into a subject, it's always the same. I just start cutting away until I get down to the image, and whether it's architecture, or whether it's a refinery, or whether it's so it's always that. And I think it's not that's not unusual for photographers. They're always doing that. What's in the frame? What's out of the frame? Where do you stand? 6 inches here makes a difference than over there. And I'm always kind of navigating that kind of space until everything goes click and it just drops in. And the light's just right, and the colors are good, and all of those things are all elements. So by doing that, by being consistent from the very beginning of my career, I think what the book shows is there's a persistence of vision, that there's a kind of a invisible style that keeps kind of coming, working through the work that still connects. Now, the one series that I did that I thought really was quite different was a pivot irrigation, because I'm looking straight down and
we'll
there's circles.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, that was quite a different break from either an oblique or off the ground. So, but it's still, over time, I think, I kind of absorbed it in. But generally speaking, you know, what the pairings did was show that there's a kind of a persistence of vision, I guess, that I was always aiming for. But I think the book helps bring that forward too.
And that's what you call the essential element.
Yeah, and then the other kind of double entendre is that, you know, I'm looking at elements that we use from the element tables, iron, copper, nickel, and I'm showing you those places, and these are essential to our lives. So there's a nice double entendre.
Absolutely.
In there as well.
And here is it's taken in Iceland, and we cannot understand that image at all. It's paired with this one I was showing just before, the grid. But what's interesting also is that what is stressed in this book is the fact that you're interested in the pattern. Sometimes the pattern is covering the whole image, but sometimes the pattern is inside the image, like in this one. And this is amazing, because in this image, we suddenly understand we have the sense of scale and space, which we didn't have in some of the images we saw before. You like that wide view that allows us to situate ourselves in that context. And we have another one here. We have two others of this series in the book, and it's very interesting to see what you did, William. One of this, like this one, I think, from Colorado, was not paired with the one I'm showing now on the left, you know. It would have been too literal, probably, for you, and there was only, like, one literal pairing that you allowed yourself to do. But you decided to put that aside, this other suburban development that is amazing because it's an anti-grid suburban development in the desert. And so here, you are going somewhere else, again, leading us to a contradiction between drying surfaces.
Well, I wouldn't do this again if I was laying it out. There were ones that I never felt clicked into the diptych mode, but then I became happy with that idea. I didn't want to have it so rhythmic that I would lull people to sleep. This comes therefore as a kind of shock treatment, because you have a kind of ideal vision of a community on the left, if you like that sort of thing, right? And on the right, you have something which is plainly disturbing and out of balance.
There are salinas in Mexico,
and
right?
Those rectangles, kind of like the paint box, seem to fight with the biomorphic forms of the community. So there are lots of, every time you put two pictures together, you create a third picture in a way. Mm-hmm. And the idea is not to destroy one. The idea is to somehow enhance both of them and not deplete one.
Ed, I wanted to ask you about the white, because there are many sections that lead us to different level and understanding what the whiteness is for you in the landscape. And so if we start here, suddenly we see the salt. It's the salt. It's about the salt on the left. And what is it on the right? It's Owen Lake. So what is that white that suddenly becomes like a painterly materiality? We're going here on like the light imprint on the surface of Earth, but then it's going really near your interest with painting.
Well, the white is actually salt on both sides of that. and so I've always been interested in that, you know, in the a lot of kind of the monochrome with punctuating color. If you look right back to my early work, color has always been a very important aspect. So I'm very conscious of it. So when I'm going to places, I'm often like waiting for the right moment to go, that the color doesn't remain the same in the landscape. And as a full season, you get different changes in color. Like, for instance, just the latest salt pan works that I just did, you know, during the monsoon, all that whole area in Gujarat, the salt pans are underwater almost, because it's raining almost daily for about 2-3 months. Then once the rain's over, you know, the gharias come up and they start to set up their pans. Then when they first put in the water, then they just look like the earth, and then you just have clear water. But late in the season, all of a sudden, each one of these pans starts to have a different color, and they start to have a beautiful white to them. So that white wouldn't be present earlier in the season. Mm-hmm. So now I'm waiting.
It's linked to time.
It's linked to time in the year where the colors come forward. Even in the forest, I wouldn't go in the summer where it's all green, but I'd wait. Maybe once most of the color leaves are off, and then I'd wait with just a little bit of color in there, and then you let that color punctuate. So I'm always very aware of kind of trying to keep neutral fields and to bring color forward in a very subtle, nuanced way. So it is a kind of that kind of visual, you know, reference points and almost painting points, mm-hmm, that I try to bring into my photography and consciously building the images. So I often said, you know, I don't take better pictures. Like, somebody gives me an iPhone, and I don't take a better snapshot than anybody else. What I do here is very different. I make these pictures. They're consciously constructed. I know where I'm going. I know what I'm after. You know, I work to get to these places. And that's, I think, you know, the difference between someone just going around and taking pictures.
I learn something every time Ed talks. I'm glad that came up because you were talking about the pivots. You were talking about the pivots and how they didn't seem to relate well. There's the Borromini architecture again. And for me, they relate beautifully.
Well, the geometry you're interested in is really striking because of the keystone and the central marker that holds the disc on the surface, and then it becomes really like totally a vertigo in relationship with reality. And this is really amazing here because we know we are in an architecture in architecture on the right, but on the left we absolutely can't understand again. You make us not understand the photographs in that book, which is really amazing, because then we have like a disorientation from pages to pages.
It's also interesting that one is looking down and one is looking up.
Yeah, absolutely.
And for me, it's part of the same sensibility.
I wanted to show this one before we ask Jennifer to join us, because this is probably the earlier image. It's the it's landscape study, so it's a study. It's an older photograph, and again about whiteness. It's very interesting because here it's really the old ground that is white, and we see how you are also a drawer. You draw with the lines. You draw with geometry. This is a very poetic image. I thought it was wonderful to have it in the book. And especially because you're doing that pairing, which is amazing, because then you have the lightness versus the density and compression of time, something very soft and ephemeral on one side. So, and what's interesting is that we are avoiding simplistic binary concept also, because it's relating also to the other images always.
Well,
before and after.
Yeah, I felt also that little peak of that little house, where a couple of little tiny fairies live, I think, in the old sense, that little peaked roof was mirrored on the right side, and then the force and density of the image on the left somehow was balanced. I mean, the image on the left, it's left of both of us. The image on the left has the equal force, even though all the density of information and so on is on the right. I really thought that was, and that I knew, or I thought, I hoped, that would force people to really look at each image individually.
So just to show you that some dark images speak about whiteness too, because this is a marble quarry, I think, and paired with this one, so that's the darker images, the dark side of the book. And still we have always something that is near the idea of water. And that's where we will ask Jennifer to join us to talk about Watermark.
Well, the thing that I find, you know, in film in general, observations are that when you have a still, there's things I really love about the still image. And the still image, it does something else to our, it embeds in our consciousness in a different way. In other words, that one image, and I often point out, like, when we think of the Vietnam War and we think of, there's tons of video footage that was shot during that war. There was but we remember, you know, the Eddie Black shot, or we remember the girl running from napalm. There's like 8 pictures that just kind of come to our minds that we can conjure up. And so the still kind of etches into our memory in a different way than the film. Now, film is this fluid thing, but we don't remember film for any singular image. We remember it more emotionally. We go for a kind of a ride, or you're going for a journey with the filmmaker, and you have music that you know sets you up as to how you should be feeling about what you're seeing. It's emotionally kind of trying to put your right pitch into the visually of what you're experiencing. And then, of course, you know, the language comes in play, and the still image where I pull these things, where I reduce it to that essential element, with the film, all of a sudden you bring the context back and you can see where these pictures come from. You can see the kids playing over there and you can, you know, see other things that the still doesn't show you. So I find that there's this really beautiful compliment about having both of them try to describe an idea.
Yeah, and there's a kind of, I mean, the capacity of film as an arena to move you intellectually, emotionally, viscerally at the same time, you can really play with that. And our films take a year to edit. I mean, they take a year, the projects are 3 to 4 year projects, so they're not, it's not like we had a script of where we were going with it and what we were gonna do. We don't work like that. We kind of do a ton of research, as Ed does a ton of research, and then we get into the environment and you're in the context and think, okay, well, how can we convey this place without disturbing it too much? I mean, we won't make any kind of sort of argument for objectivity in terms of documentary, but there is a way of telling the truth about somewhere. And in some cases, like in manufactured landscapes, we were forbidden to talk to anybody in any of the places we went to. And every time we tried, in fact, often Ed would be, you know, shooting away, and as soon as we turned on our camera, we would have to negotiate. And so often, Peter Mettler, our cinematographer, would be off shooting while I was still negotiating whether we could turn on the camera and shoot. And by the time they'd said no, we already had something. But when we were told that we couldn't talk to anybody, that's complicated because the human element, I mean, that back and forth I was talking about earlier about looking in close at the details, standing back to see the wide view, that going back and forth, we had to figure out another way to do that. So the women making the spray mechanisms for irons in manufactured landscapes, or the boy in the rice paddies, who's the rice paddy guard, you know, we just have to spend time with them. You stay on their faces for a while, and the tedium of that work enters you. You understand what that work is. You understand the fact that these women are making these ridiculous little things all day long. They're in the photograph. You would have to look in close to see them. So our way of spending time with them is to linger with them there. We have to find other ways of expressing the detail and the human element, the narrative.
And it's true that there's a lot of moments where there's a silence, we don't have people explaining anything, it's very contemplative, and then we know that you don't want to have a statement or bring a message, a clear message to that.
Well, let me just, the Bangladesh sequence, which you all saw, so there was a moment where we actually spent quite a bit of time talking to the Buriganga river keeper, and we walked, literally, he walked along the river and talked about all of the chemicals that are discharged into that river every day without any kind of treatment. Hexavalent chromium is the one that is the most carcinogenic. So it was very powerful talking to him, and he gave the whole list and everything. However, when you see the woman bathing and the father washing his son's face, that did it. So the non-didactic approach feels, again, it's the visceral, emotional, intellectual simultaneously. It all comes together in some way. And that doesn't happen often, but that was a kind of mainline to the point of what that was trying to convey.
And you don't have to say anything.
No, exactly.
Yeah.
Also, I'd also like to add to the approach that we take, because I think, again, like the still, the still image doesn't tell you what to think about it. And nor do my text, at the end of the oil, if you go through the oil book or any of these books, China, I think if you go through the book at the other end of it, you go, things aren't quite right with the world. I can't see you come out the other side of it going, that was great. This is fabulous what's happening out there. So I think it's implied. So it's implicit, not explicit. And I think it's the same thing we're trying to do in the films, that we're not trying to tell you how to think, but if you can walk away and not feel something and not think about the water the next time you turn it on, and feel something differently about the preciousness of it, the importance of it, you know, the way in which it can be abused and the way it nourishes us both through life and also through enjoyment and through going into the beach and enjoying swimming and all that. So there's all these other things, and you know, so we just try to, and I think they're not, in that way, they're not classic documentaries. They're some kind of hybrid between an art film and with a deep layer of information and storytelling that we're trying to pull through there too. And to me, with Jennifer, and that's the magic she had, like in Manufactured Landscapes, it was very similar in that, you know, she went in and took a lot of archival footage. All that black and white footage was archival footage from somebody else. And kind of, and it was turned into a film, but it was so, call it BBC, you know, and I went, I can't do it.
No, so, no offense.
No offense. No, but it was just a classic, you know, this is what's happening in the shipyards of Bangladesh, and that's not what I wanted. And so that's how Jennifer and I began to work. And then she took that same footage, and then she wrapped it around this, you know, work with China and Peter Mettler, who's an amazing filmmaker in his own right, and we were so fortunate to have him at that time. And we put it all together, and when you come out through Manufactured Landscapes, to me it was a similar thing, that you come out and you haven't been told anything, but damn, next time you see Made in China, it sure feels different. You know, it's shifted your consciousness just that much that you'll never see Made in China in the same way again. And to me, that is the power that film can do that I could never do with the stills. You can get it and you get people thinking about it, and they're great departure points to talk about it. And if you push harder into those pictures, you can kind of start to glean more and more, but the film kind of just takes it there a little more powerfully, I think. Okay, how many people in the room have heard of the word Anthropocene? That's a great, this is the best room ever. You know, this is 50%. No. And that's then, and so when that word came forward about 12 years ago, Ted Cruz,
Paul Crutzen.
Paul Crutzen. Wrong guy.
Yes, but absolutely the wrong guy. Sorry.
But anyways, it was like all of a sudden, you know, and he's a Nobel Prize winner. He recognized that something's happening to the planet, that we're moving from the Holocene, which is about 12,000 years long now, to a new state of the planet. Which is anthropo-man scene change, so man changing the state of the planet, which we're flipping to another state. And humans are the event. In the past, the extinction event 65 million years ago, meteor hits off the Yucatan Peninsula, a big, huge iridium dust cloud comes off of it, so it was like 6 kilometers wide when it hit, a 10-year dark winter, they assumed, where there's no photosynthesis, all the dinosaurs died. 70% of life is extinguished, and then small mammals, birds have survived, and possibly even giving us a leg up because, you know, T-Rexes are not good for humans, and they disappeared. So giving mammals a better chance at things. So that happened, but now we're in this state, and that's what the next project we're doing is. And in a way, my work for 35 years, all of a sudden I went, hey, you know, in a way I've been poking at this same idea for 35 years that we as a species, the terraforming we're doing, the changing, the oil that we're burning, all this is tipping us into another state. So in a way, what we're trying to do is, the positive, hopeful thing we're trying to do is raise consciousness, that there is this other world that is suffering for our success. In other words, we're building these beautiful cities. And I often say now to people, if you have trouble with this mining landscape, you know, which creates nickel, which creates stainless steel, then you look at a stainless steel girders on our towers. These things are equivalent. So if you have trouble and you think that's a terrible photograph, you should look at, or a terrible image of a place, then our cities are a terrible image as well, because there's equivalence there. You can't have one without the other. So it's not a question, I don't think today, of we can stop taking from nature. That's naive. It's how we take from nature and what we leave behind, and whether we're destroying habitats along the way in a reckless way. And it doesn't matter if it's in the Amazon or if now it's in Africa, and I'm looking at Africa. If we do it recklessly, then we deserve what we get. We now know that you can't go in there and just let a corporation do it as cheap as possible to give us cheap stuff. It can't be done. You have to do it properly and making sure that the species that are there aren't being destroyed. The water that's there isn't being tainted, so nobody downstream can drink that water. We now know. It's not like we're naive. And if we let those, by bringing awareness that these places are growing rapidly, we're using up resources, we're moving from a period of plenty where everybody has everything, the grocery stores are full, and we may be entering a period of scarcity. And we better be aware that, because it's going to run out. The oceans are running out of food.
The positive aspect of that, that also could be, it's true. I mean, we could just go down a road of despair. We have the capacity to change things and to change the way that we take. And I think that the project, our idea, and why we think it's positive is that if we combine a whole bunch of different elements and different media together to try to convey the same thing and use the best medium for that attempt to convey, so whether it's virtual reality or photography or film or a book or a video installation, we're trying to put all of that together, marshal all of that into one kind of far-reaching project in an attempt to raise awareness for this. Because I think that I think it will have an impact, not just if there's an official name change of the epoch from Holocene to Anthropocene, but just in the fact that we are actually considering that humans now change the planet more than all other natural processes combined. That's pretty astonishing.
Is that an existential threat? The number one, I think, is still nuclear. I mean, we can kind of flatten this planet one day, take out almost everything that's living if it was just an all-out nuclear war. But another second greatest existential threat is the environment. Now, if we tip the planet and can't pull it back, we're going for a ride. And then, of course, there's geopolitics and all, and food and famine and water and all those other things, but they're below those two things. I think those are the two things that keep me up at night, amongst others. So I think, that environmental one is the one that I think we can help in that conversation and want to push that idea forward.
I will thank you very much and invite you to join us on the first floor for a signature.